How is everyone doing? Good. It's a pleasure to be here today, and I couldn't have asked for a better event and a more beautiful stage to give my first conference talk. So, yeah. A little bit about me. I'm a QA automation consultant at VML, and I started my career as a software developer. Found my passion in testing, and automated testing has been a focus of my career from last couple of years. And today I want to talk about some of the challenges that I have faced in implementing those solutions and some of the techniques that I've used to solve them. So I guess let's get started. Before we get started, can we have a show of hands, please? How many testers do we have in the room? QA? Anybody related to QA testers? Okay, very few. And how many of you are actually implementing automated testing in your deployment pipeline? That's a lot. Well, I hope after listening to my talk, you will consider implementing automated testing. All right, so let's get started. Now, whether you are a bank or insurance company or a startup, every single company is obsessed with one thing, and that's speed. It's about how fast you can pull from an idea to something that gets deployed to production and we start making money out of it, right? And that's the reason we all are here today discussing DevOps, because we all want our businesses to be successful. Now, the pressure to faster release is unprecedented. And while the focus is on speed, oftentimes the quality gets compromised. And guess what? Speed without quality kills. Now think about it for a minute. What is the value in deploying a broken application 100 times faster or 200 times faster or 500 times faster? It's not going to make it any less broken. So focusing only on automated deployments without building the quality in is ultimately a process set up for failure, just like this. So what we really need is not just speed, but speed with quality. All right, so Computing Magazine did a recent DevOps survey, and when they asked where the main holdups are in their software production process, 63% of the companies said the delays were occurring in the testing or the QA stage of the cycle. Now, if you look at this chart, it's almost double the planned code stage. So what this really implies is that QA has become the biggest bottleneck in DevOps. Now, again, how many of you agree with this? Do you guys think QA is a bottleneck for you? Okay, I see some hands there. What about others? Others are happy with their QA process, all good? No, I see some nods there. Okay, I know what you guys are thinking. You guys might be thinking that, of course, QA has always been a bottleneck, and even now, I'm a bottleneck between you and your lunch, so yeah, that was a bad joke. All right, so one of the reasons cited by these companies was that QA is not able to match up to the speed of continuous deployment. And the reason for that is a lot of these companies still rely on the traditional testing practices like manual testing. So if we have to move fast, then manual testing has to die. So manual testing as your primary testing strategy is dead. Why? Because it's very, very slow. In today's digital time, when our releases are getting compressed and our deployment cycles are getting shorter, QA only has few hours or maybe just few days to complete their testing. So unless you have a big army of thousands of manual testers, manual testing is not an option. And just to clarify, manual testing in the form of exploratory testing will always be there. There is always some human touch that will be needed. But manual testing as your primary testing strategy is definitely dead. So how do we remove QA as a bottleneck and ensure that we build better apps faster And that's where automated testing comes to the rescue. Now, automation really is the dictate of today. It is at the heart of DevOps. And so if you adopt DevOps, test automation is a must. Now, Mike Cohen, who's a very famous author of the book, I don't know how many of you guys have read this, but I highly recommend it. It's Succeeding with Agile. So he gave a test pyramid to develop your test strategy. So what this basically talks about is having automated tests at different layers of your application architecture. So at your technology-facing tests, you have unit tests, component tests, integration tests, and these are usually written by the developers. And then at the business-facing tests, you have functional tests and web services tests. Now, if you see the inverted triangle, that shows the test coverage. So your functional tests have the maximum coverage, end-to-end coverage, whereas your unit tests have a granular level coverage. Now, a common trap a lot of companies get into when they first start into test automation is to go crazy with automating just one layer of the application, that is 100% automate, 100% unit test or 100% functional test. Now, a best practice really is to automate the tests based on the value they add to your project. So for example, if you are testing a checkout process for an e-commerce website, then an end-to-end test will most likely be appropriate. Whereas if you are testing, say, a business calculation for a discount in a shopping cart, then a unit test will most likely suffice. Now, next I want to talk about the technology stack that we use at VML. For the unit testing, we use JUnit, then Jasmine behavior-driven framework. For web services testing, we use Postman and RAML. And for end-to-end UI testing, we use Selenium WebDriver. Now, Selenium is an open source technology, and when it came 10 or 15 years ago, it was a totally disruptive technology. Like, there was no browser automation tool available at that time. And in last 10 years, it has really become the industry standard, so much so that 70% of the market today is controlled by Selenium. And all the new technologies in the user interface testing that are coming are built on top of Selenium. So we use Serenity as our behavior-driven testing framework on top of Selenium. So Serenity helps us describe our acceptance test in a Gherkin kind of a format, which is given, when, then. And it's the same format in which a lot of us get our user stories and our acceptance criteria. So that helps us to have a shared understanding with the technical as well as the non-technical members in the team. Now, one of the latest technology that we have added to our toolbox and that I'm really excited about is Apply Tools. So Apply Tools is an automated visual testing tool, and it allows you to do automated visual tests. So you can now test the visual aspects of a web page, like font, color, layout, content, images, and those are the things that Selenium cannot test. So it has added a really big capability as far as our test automation suite is concerned. We also use Sauce Labs as our cloud testing platform for compatibility testing. Now, if you haven't heard about Sauce Labs, it provides you more than 700 different devices as well as browser combinations. And the newest capability they added is predictive analytics. And what that really tells you is that, and if you go to like any of the reports for Forrester or Gartner, it will tell you that predictive analytics is the future of QA. And with Sauce Labs getting that capability, it shows us where the trend is moving towards. So that was about our compatibility testing, and most of our tests run on Jenkins. We recently added Groovy scripting to create our dynamic pipeline. So that helps us create reusable framework that we can scale across multiple multiple projects. We also use New Relic, specifically New Relic Synthetics, and we can create test monitors using that. So And New Relic Synthetics helps you create Selenium tests on top of JavaScript. And using that, you can do continuous site monitoring. And just so you know, I'm not affiliated with New Relic. I know they have a counter outside, and I have a sticker here, but they got really good stickers outside, in case you want to check out. So we use JMeter for our performance testing and Total Validator for accessibility testing. Then we use Burp Suite for our security testing. So that was about the toolbox. I just want to show a sample test report. So here's the important thing to note here is that it takes like 3 minutes to execute 25 user stories, whereas if you have to perform the same test using manual testing, it will take at least 6 hours to do the job. So that's the power of automated testing. Like, you can save time and resources. And imagine if you have to scale this to say you have to cover 10 more browsers, then you can just run the same test in parallel for 3 minutes. Whereas if you have to do this for manual testing, you will take 60 hours to do the same job. So that's where the power of automation comes in. All right, so what is holding people from embracing test automation? And in my experience, it's one thing to implement test automation, set the system up and running, and it's another to really maintain it and keep it useful. And I think it gets a lot harder as you scale. So the challenge to create reliable automated tests is what a lot of companies struggle with, and that kind of makes them wonder that, you know what, I like test automation, but I don't trust it. And one of the main hurdles in implementing a reliable testing solution is flaky tests. Have you guys, any of you guys have come across flaky tests? I see some hands there. Really, is that so uncommon? Everybody got stable tests? All right, so what is a flaky test? A test that is observed to be both passed and failed for the same application code is called flaky test. Now, anyone who has done serious test automation knows how painful they are, and it is the fastest way to lose trust in your automation testing. So what happens when you have flaky tests? Let's see. So here's an example of the unstable flaky test producing two different test results for the same application. Now, as you can see in the snapshot, the first build has 6% failed, 92% passed, whereas the second build has 4% failed and 93% passed. So why do you think we get different passed and failed results? And which of the ones will you trust? Anyone? Which of the ones are you going to trust? Which of the ones are you going to trust and go live to your production? None, right? Okay. So it seems like your CI server, your Jenkins, is actually raising false alarms and is actually crying wolf, similar to the story of the boy who cried wolf. Now, there is nothing worse than the tests that cry wolf. Just like this story, just like in the story, no one trusts the test anymore. And because the build is always broken due to flaky tests, and the build is ignored by the team. And why is that a problem? Why ignoring the broken build a problem? And that's the reason why it is a problem. Because it promotes bad culture. It promotes bad culture that it is okay to ignore the failed test, that it is okay to ignore the failed build. The second reason is that it completely discredits your automated testing effort. And when it discredits your automated testing effort, the team has no other option but to go back to manual testing, and QA remains the bottleneck. So that's my takeaway, that flaky tests should not be tolerated. Now, just to give you a sense of scale, Google has around 4.2 million tests that run on the continuous integration system. Of these, around 63,000, that is less than 2%, have a flaky run over a week. And if you listen to Google testing conference last year, every second talk was about either identifying, monitoring, or fixing flaky tests. So that gives you an idea about how important and how common this problem is. So when you guys say there are no flaky tests in your test suite, I feel like there's some little secret there. All right, if you guys are interested, I highly recommend Google Testing blog to get an insight into the various techniques they use to create stable and reliable tests. Some of these techniques I will cover in the next section. So how do we build reliable tests? Let's see, I'll give you five tips that are my go-to tips. Quarantine your flaky tests. Now what does that mean? So that means removing noise from the signal. Now group your stable green tests in one test suite and quarantine the red flaky tests. So this way we can continue to get the correct feedback from your stable tests. And the idea here is not to abandon these tests, but to separate them, fix them, and then bring them back into your main build. So let's say you ended up with just 40% of your original test suite. But that's the test suite that you can trust, and that's the feedback that you can trust. And we knew if this failed, then we have to stop everything and fix our broken line. All right, so Facebook also uses the same technique. The only difference is they have automated bots to group the tests. So whenever a new test comes in their continuous integration pipeline, if it passes, it goes to the green group, that is a good test, and if it fails and is identified as a flaky test, then it is grouped as a flaky test, and it's quarantined, it's fixed, and then brought back into the main pipeline. All right, the second step really is to consider flaky tests as a friend. Now, it's easy to dismiss flaky results as a problem with the automated tools or test environment, but use flaky tests to your advantage, really. Dig into them and see if they are really, what is happening to the system. It might be masking a key system failure. The third step really is to understand the source of flakiness. Now there could be a lot of sources, but these are the top four that I always come across, and it's asynchronous behavior, concurrency, third-party web services call if you're making, or it may be the order in which you're running your tests. So let's look at them one by one. So asynchrony is a boon for software because that's what allows our browser to be responsive, and then while it goes back to the server and gets more data. But in testing, asynchrony can be a curse. How? So because we have to wait for the server response here. As you can see in the code snippet here, a common mistake here is to throw in a sleep and then wait for 5 seconds for the response. Now this particular test will fail if the server response comes back after 5 seconds. So if you're still putting sleep in your code, wake up people. Use intelligent waits instead. Why? Because that will help you not wait on the server response. Now, if you're using Selenium WebDriver, you can use WebDriver wait class, or if you can use explicit wait, or maybe a fluent wait. Now, sometimes the tests that run individually can fail when you run them in parallel. So the reason could be they can run into the race conditions, or they can get into a deadlock, or they might be sharing the same test data. So to prevent unstable tests during parallel execution, you can either thread safe your test code or make your test more atomic, or avoid having shared resources or shared test accounts if they are using one. The fourth and my favorite point really is love your test code as much as you love your application code. And why is that important? Because a robust test automation framework is really the foundation of creating stable tests. The best practice really is to implement the solid software design principles. I don't know how many of you know solid. What is solid? Okay, I see some developers there, so they know it. Yeah, solid, single responsibility, open close, all those principles. So we use this extensively in our test automation framework. So if you use a Selenium WebDriver, then you can probably do a class which does the only job for that class is to do assertions. So that's where those are some of the solid principles that you can implement. We also use design patterns like page object model, which is a very popular design pattern used for creating end-to-end user interface tests. Or you can use factory design pattern. Now, you can also do static code analysis using tools like SonarQube to ensure that your code quality is the same standards as your application code quality. So those are really my go-to tips as far as creating a solid, robust test automation framework. And the fifth point really is, it's a very simple rule of thumb that I usually apply. And whenever I find myself refactoring an unstable test for like more than three times, and I keep adding bandages to it, I feel like if it's after three times, I stop doing that and control alt delete and then rewrite everything. This might seem like a wasteful task in terms of time and resources, but sometimes really a fresh perspective is what you need to test design, and a test design is all you need. So it's okay to start over. So quality is really a team sport, and so far we have seen the technical challenges in implementing automated testing, but what really differentiates high-performing team from low-performing team is its culture. And remember, culture is always more important than tools and technologies. A culture of continuous quality requires each and every person in the team to be accountable for quality. Now, you might be wondering, if I'm a developer, how can I help with quality? So if you're a developer, you can help with quality by making your code more testable, or maybe creating more, helping with more stable identifiers that we can use for our Selenium tests. Or maybe you can do TDD, test-driven development, or maybe you can write more unit tests in your automated testing pipeline. And if you're an operations person, maybe you can help us with creating Jenkins pipeline or a Docker container. And if you're a product owner in a Scrum team, then maybe you can help us by including automated testing in your definition of done. So quality really is a team sport. And with that, I want to just point out some key takeaways for my talk. Test automation is a must if you don't want your car to go off the cliff. And trust is crucial. Flaky tests should not be tolerated. And everyone participates in quality. Thank you so much for your attention. Here's my LinkedIn and Twitter information, and I would like to continue the conversation in open spaces today, if you guys are interested. And here are our sponsors.
Awesome. Thank you very much.